Well, good morning. Happy New Year, Harvest. It's been a while. It's good to see everyone in God's house today. I hope you're excited to get into His Word. Can we just thank God for vertical worship and the ministry that they have shared with our church all over Chicago? We're joined now today with all of our campuses, and 2020 is going to bring a number of changes around our church. And over the next 7 to 10 days, there's going to be a big change in vertical worship. In fact, Pastor Eddie Hoagland, who will be preaching next weekend, is expecting another addition to their family. And yeah, isn't that amazing? And Jake, who is in vertical worship, Jake is expecting within days, if not hours, their first child, he and Lauren. And I just thought that this was a great time to announce a new group that's coming out of vertical worship called Vertical Babies. About 6 years, we'll be releasing our first album. We're going to remix Yes, I Will to Yes, They Did. It's going to be amazing. You don't want to miss that, so stay tuned. Today, we are launching a new three-week mini-series called If Then. If Then, and we are in the book of 2 Chronicles, the 7th chapter. And so I want to invite you all over Chicagoland, if you would run right now in your Bibles to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And we're going to be looking in particular at verse 14 through 16. But I have the work today by God's grace to set the tone for the series. And I'm calling this talk today, nine words. Nine words, that's all they gave me, is nine words. And the nine words that I have is, if my people who are called by my name. If my people who are called by my name. But because we know that the text is a little bit more than that, I want to invite you to go to your Bible as I read 2 Chronicles chapter 14, 15, 16. We're going to read those verses. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there for all time. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of His word. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much for every person that is gathered at Harvest Bible Chapel this weekend. They came wanting to hear a word from you, not a word from me, God. And so I pray less of me and more of you in this hour, that your word would go forth with power and authority, that you would arrest our imaginations, God, that you would take our hearts and our ears, and that you would illuminate your word so that we would be more effective disciples for you. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. The year was 1991, 92, and I was in college. And I don't know about you, if you can remember the first time that you caught a glimpse of spiritual hunger. The first time that you caught a glimpse of when people were hungry for something that they couldn't see. I was coming from a party. Yes, your pastor was coming from a party. And when we partied, we believed in partying with authority. And so it was great. It was a late night, and going away, I saw some students that were heading to church with their Bibles. I thought, what a weird thing to do on a Sunday morning for college students, to go and be with the Lord. And so I asked one of the college students, hey, what's with this little group that I noticed? And they're, well, going to this church, but Ed, you maybe should come and visit us. We have prayer every day at the chapel at noon. You see, they lost me at prayer every day. But every day they had prayer at this chapel on campus, and it was about 20 or 30 students that were showing up. And And there was a holy discontent among this group of students that they believed that God loved the campus more than they ever could. And the name of the group was InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. And I had never heard about InterVarsity Christian Fellowship on college campuses, but I was told that it was a group by students for students, and they were just praying and seeking God, and a funny thing happened. One of the guys invited me to come to small group in a dorm called Goss Hall. And see, you don't know Goss Hall, but Goss Hall was affectionately nicknamed the zoo on campus. It was a boys' dorm at that time, and it was amazing what happened at the zoo. Furniture could be mobile. Windows could be opened and things thrown out of them. There could be parties and any number of things that happened in the zoo. But this group of men, they had a Bible study on Monday night, and they invited me to come to the Bible study. So I sacrificed and gave up Monday night football and a few extra games of pool, and I went to the Bible study. And I walked in, and I saw these men studying the book of Acts and later the book of Mark. And they were passionate about Jesus, and they invited me to come back. I messed around, and I showed back up at Bible study again, and the Lord started to speak to me, and I started to see that this holy discontent that these students had was real, that they wanted to see their friends come to Jesus Christ. And by the end of that year, they planted a chapter, and there were about 60 students that were showing up every week, and they would have speakers and prayer and worship. And by the time I graduated, that group was over 100 students on a 1,500-member campus. But that's not the end of the story. That holy discontent continued and permeated throughout the town. And churches began to experience revival by some of the students who stayed around and went to those churches. And I came back to speak 4 years later after the Lord had arrested my life, and I went into campus ministry. And over 900 students were gathered at worship, so many that they could not have worship in the chapel. They had to meet outside. That started from this small group of students that had a holy discontent. I wonder what it would be like for us at Harvest in 2020. What would it be like if we had spiritual discontent? What if you are walking around and you said, there has to be more than this. God is at work. There has to be more than this. My life was made for more than this. Well, if that's you, I'm glad that you're at church today, because Solomon had that same feeling. In the book of 1 and 2 Chronicles, we see a hunger for God's glory. In 1 Chronicles, the book is about the building of the temple, just to give you a little bit of background. And it really is focused on Solomon's dad, David. And David was a man after God's own heart. We'll talk about him a little bit later, but David was rather complex. There were a lot of things that were in his life, but one of the things he was consistent about is he was focused on God. But the second thing is, 2 Chronicles is about the actual building of the temple and, unfortunately, the destruction of the temple. You see, God had told David in 1 Chronicles chapter 22, David, I know that you want to build the temple, but the reality is you've shed way too much blood in war. There's a little bit too much history in your life. Any of you can relate to the history that is in your life before Christ? Thank you so much, the 15 people that can identify with me. That some of us have history. We have a true Hollywood story about our lives before Jesus Christ. And God let David know, hey, I love you, but the reality is this. You don't get to build my temple, but look what he did. He said, your son will. My promise is still with you, and your son will build the temple. But there's another thing that you need to understand about the text before we understand what God is saying in verse 14 through 16, is that the book is written by a chronicler. Many theologians believe it's Ezra, but we're unsure. But here's the deal. He was writing the book to a people in exile over 500 years after the events that we're reading about. So the book was not written to Solomon, and the book was not written to the people at that time. It was written to exiles, reminding them of their identity in God, reminding them that they had a royal priesthood as a father, reminding them that while they were in exile, that they were created for more. Harvest, I want to remind you that if you name the name of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have an excellent future and an amazing past. God is not done with you. God is not done with his purposes in the world. The reality is this: God is still on the throne. And the chronicler wanted the people to understand that God was still at work. Now, to understand chapter 7, you need to understand chapter 6. Solomon did something that was amazing to me. Leaders lead. And what he did is he first blessed God's people. Isn't it amazing when you're blessed? Isn't it amazing when someone speaks to you and shares blessing into your life? Whether it's your father or your mother or a teacher, a pastor or minister, when they look at you and they call out greatness in you before you even know that God is at work. And that's what Solomon did. He blessed God's people at the beginning of chapter 6. But then he went on to dedicate the temple, and he began a prayer. I want to submit to you in your quiet time today, you should go to chapter 6 and look at what God said. Not just what God said at the end, but what Solomon said to God. Solomon prayed, and he prayed a preemptive prayer. And the prayer was full of asking God for his presence when God's people would sin. I found that a little curious. This was not talking about people not following God. He's talking about his chosen people. And he reminds God of a promise that he made to his daddy. You said that if we called on you, if we named your name higher than anyone else, that you would be with us, God. I'm just asking that you would do that. And in verse 18, one of the sweetest verses in the Old Testament for me, we see Solomon saying, the presence of God can't even be contained in this house. I'm building a house and I'm building a palace for the king, but the reality is this: you and your presence, God, can't even be contained in this place. I'm so thankful that we have all around Chicagoland a place to worship God, but don't you yearn for the time where God's glory would fill the house, that it can't even be contained? We had to put messages on the screen. Excuse me, service will start in 15 minutes. People are still coming. People are still coming to hear the word of God, not to hear Ed, not to see vertical worship. They're coming for the presence of God. And here in chapter 6, he says something at the end of the prayer. And I want you all to see this. I want you to look real quickly at verse 34 at the end of 6. If your people go out to battle against your enemies, by whatever way you shall send them, and they pray toward this city that you have chosen and the house that I built for your name, then hear from heaven their prayer and their plea and maintain their cause. God, I'm asking you, if anybody in the future calls on your name, if anybody calls on your name when they're in trouble, would you hear their prayers and would you go before them? It leads us to our first point today, that if I worship God, the reality is this: then I will see him more clearly. If I worship God more fully, I will see him more clearly. Harvest, I submit to you today that something is happening in our worship. We're being called to a higher place as a people of God, and it takes a different level of worship. It's not just worship in our singing, it's also we worship God in our doing. In our being throughout the week, as we connect with one another, as we connect with our families, there's an identity that you are made in the image of God. God knows how to make an entrance, does he not? When God shows up, you don't have to ask the question, hey, was that God? Was that him? Well, we see in verse 1 of chapter 7 that as soon as Solomon finished his prayer, God made an entrance. He didn't say a word, but look what the Bible says that happened. That fire came down from heaven and it consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests and the pastors could not enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the house. And when all the people saw the fire come down and the glory of the Lord of the temple, look what they did. They bowed down with their knees and they worshiped. And what did they say? For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. The reality is, praising God brings a proper perspective in our lives. I don't know about you, but when I turn my attention away from the things that I'm experiencing and I turn my attention heavenward on God, I start to see the events in my life in a different way. I start to yearn for God in a way that is unusual, not common. And maybe that's your story as well. That when you worship God more fully and you focus on him, we see him differently. Solomon knew that blessings, though, came with curses and covenants. Last week, we've been doing this all through the worship service. We've been remembering that one word. We've been remembering that one word, the focus that that one word brings. It brings to mind a question that I want to ask you that we'll marinate in this series together. What can I do in 2020 to better see God, hear God, and walk with God? What is it that I can do? Make it personal. What is it I can do to walk with God and to see him more clearly, to hear him more clearly? Well, for me, my word in 2020 is the word focus. As we've been studying and looking at the life of Jesus in the book of Mark for most of last fall, and we will most of this year, I've been struck by the simple strategy that both God and Jesus had to change the world. And it was very simple. It was a focus on changing the human heart. It wasn't actions. It wasn't primarily to set out and change the way that people behaved on the outside. He knew without a heart being changed that outward change would be short-lived. That you can't continue to be different if your heart hasn't been changed. Anybody identify with that? I know, it's the same with me, that if your heart hasn't changed, it's very difficult. And so the question then began for me, what's the condition of my heart? Not the people, but Ed, what's the condition of your heart before God? I hear the words, but what's the condition of your heart? And God does something that just blows my mind. God receives the offering of sinful people, and how do they respond? They turn it up a notch. This is the origin of the term turned up, for those that are wondering. This is where it started, that the people of God and Solomon got turned up and said, let's worship some more. Let's do more. So they had more sacrifices brought out, and Solomon led in the eighth day with 22,000 of his own oxen and 120,000 sheep. Just his personally that he offered up as an offering to God. Is there any offering that's too great for God? Is there anything that's too great for God to sacrifice and to give to him? I'm gonna model as the leader how to go forth and sacrifice and serve God. And the people responded. The Bible says in verse 6, the priests stood at their posts, and the Levites also with the instruments of music to the Lord that King David had made and given thanks to the Lord. Everybody was giving praise and thanks to God. And Solomon had to build an additional altar for all of the sacrifices that were given. It leads me to the second point today, that if God makes a promise, then I will trust his conditions. If God makes a promise, then I will trust his conditions. I love the intimacy in verses 11 through 13, that Solomon finished the house of the Lord in the king's house, all that Solomon had planned to do in the house of the Lord and his own house, he successfully accomplished. Newsflash for everyone in the room, planning is a beautiful thing. How many of you, if you're honest, you said, I'm a planner. I'm a planner. That's me too. I'm a goal setter. I'm a planner. I like to get after it. I like to get after it. Let's pick the goals. Let's get after it. Let's stop talking about it. Let's be about it. Let's do something. It's great to accomplish goals, but don't accomplish goals without God. Solomon had a single focus. I'm going to complete the palace and the temple. But then listen to what the Lord did. The Lord appeared to Solomon in the night, and he said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. Is that not beautiful? The God of the universe, the creator God, decides to come and say, I've heard your prayer. Harvest, some of you, under the sound of my voice, you've been praying to God for a long time. And you wonder whether or not God has heard your prayer. I know it's not news to you, but can I reaffirm what I believe? I believe that God has heard your prayer. You're not praying to an absentee God. You're not praying to someone who doesn't know your name and your address. You're not praying to someone who mixed up your prayer with someone else. God himself, he heard the prayer of his servant Solomon. John Piper says this phrase often, and I thought of it, and I thought this is so pertinent for this moment, that God is most glorified in us when we're most satisfied in him. God's most glorified in us when we're most satisfied in him. Let me ask you a question this morning. How satisfied are you with God? I'm satisfied with my wife and my kids, satisfied with those that I work with and have the privilege to talk with and share with at Harvest Bible Church. I'm just so satisfied with that. God's asking me, Ed, are you more satisfied with me than any of that? God outlined in advance what the attitudes and the actions of the people should be to restore his name and to restore his glory. And if you want to look very closely, I love that God answered with detail what was asked in chapter 6, beginning at the 26th through the 31st verse. Solomon said, as an agrarian society that they have, God, if there's drought, would you bring rain? God, if the locusts come, would you deliver us? God, if there is pestilence and plague, would you deliver us? And God says in the text, when I shut up, verse 13, the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people. He says, when, not if, when. Harvest, I'm here to tell you that the Christian life is not easy. In this world, you will have trouble. You're not exempt from trouble or hardship or difficult times as a believer, amen? You don't get very many shouts and amens on that. The house doesn't go up when you mention that. But God himself is saying, when I do this, when I allow this to happen to my people out of disobedience, there's a remnant of people who I will honor. Amen. If my people who are called by my name, is where he begins. It's not everybody. The people of Israel are my people, by the way. Newsflash, it's not the United States. He's talking to the people of Israel. But we as Christians, we can take the principles as the church of this passage, that if my people who are called by my name, if my people denotes ownership, you're not your own, you're mine. I, God, own you. You are mine. And if my people who are called, to be called, that word translated means to be summoned by God, to be beckoned by God. If my people who identify and know who they are, who worship me, if they are called by my name, I have something for you. And next week, Pastor Eddie is going to pick up at the end of that. But I want to tell you about the challenge of focusing and giving everything to God. Notice I said that if God makes a promise, then I have to trust his conditions. I haven't always trusted God's conditions. It reminds me of a story that we'll share in a few weeks from Mark chapter 10. It was a rich young man. And by all indications, ladies, he had it all going on. He was a good man. He was outstanding in the community. He had some money in the bank, amen. You don't have to be shy about it, ladies, amen. He had some money in the bank. He was a rich young man. But here's the deal. He came and he asked Jesus a question. By all indications, it was coming from a good place. He said, what is it that I need to do to inherit the kingdom of God? What is it that I need to have eternal life? How many of you get scared when you ask God a question? I get really scared when God asks me questions. Because do you think that God doesn't know the answer to the question he's asking me? He's the only person in the world who always knows the answer to the question. And so Jesus looked at him, and the Bible says he loved him. He looked at him with compassion, and then he dropped a bomb. There's one thing you need to do. What I need you to do is I need you to sell everything you have, give everything you have to the poor, and follow me. I know what your one thing is, and I'm going to ask and I'm going to challenge you to give up that one thing. If I were there and I could act this out, this is the way that I think that the rich young man, his facial expressions went. And I excuse you if you don't like looking at my face too close, but I just want you to see how I read this text this week in chapter 10. Hey, Jesus, how could I inherit eternal life? So good to meet you. I've always wanted to meet you. What do I need to do? That's how it went. The Bible said he went away sad. He missed the opportunity. Newsflash, don't miss this. This was the only person in the New Testament that Jesus said to sell everything that you have and follow me. We could have had a 13th disciple. And he missed out on the one thing that could have changed his life, because he was holding on to his one thing. Harvest all over Chicagoland, let me ask you this. What are you holding on that God is asking you to let go so he can be God in your life? What is it that you're holding on? Is it your money? Is it your family? Is it your job and prestige? What is it that you're holding on to? Your commitment to the Bears football team? I mean, what is it? You should be easily able to let that go. But what is it that you're committed to? What is it that you're committed to? I want to share a failure in my life this last year. A lot of times pastors like to share the good things, you know, how God moved. And God's done a lot of things. But I failed in one of my goals last year. And the reason why I failed was a little phrase that my dad used to often say. He'd say, son, I just want you to know this. The hardest thing in the world to do is something that you don't want to do. it reminded me that before God will ever do something through me or through us, that God has to do a work in us. Before he does anything through us, he has to do a work in us. And one of the works that I was asking the Lord, I wanted to get better in some areas of fitness. And I failed. Got on the scale at the end of the year during my goal review. Scale just looked right back at me. Said, "You're down 3 pounds. You crushed it this year." Not really. I missed my goal. You know why I missed my goal, church? Because midway through the year, I didn't want to achieve my goal. I decided that it wasn't important. I decided that the Church of Jesus Christ at Geno's and Giordano's was more important than the goal that I had. I decided that the disciples that gathered at Velvet Taco needed me. And I needed to do some worship at their place. I just believed that Coca-Cola was meant to be a member of Harvest Bible Chapel, and Dr. Pepper joined along. That's the reason why I didn't accomplish my goal. I absolutely didn't want to do it. Is there anybody else like me that just, you don't want, yeah. There's a rebellion in our hearts often toward God that we don't want to do what he calls us to do. But this is where we end it today. If God is my one thing, then I will trust him for the provision that I need. If God is my one thing, then I will trust him with the provision that I need. Harvest, we are trusting and believing God for the unthinkable in 2020. There is a holy discontent that is rising in the hearts of God's people all over Chicago that we don't want to just be average followers of Jesus Christ. We want to love our neighbors as ourselves. We want to be the children of God wherever we are. And he says that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. There's a distinction, there's a characteristics that we have as believers that people should recognize that we actually are with God. It's funny, sometimes your family, when you're around, when you're little, and you're kind of walking and doing your thing, and I remember my aunt used to say, "Oh Lord, that boy, he just walks like his daddy." You know that's an Ollie. He just walks like his dad. He sounds like his dad. The question is, do you sound like your daddy today? Do you sound like the words of Jesus Christ? Does your life emulate the love that Jesus Christ has? If you were arrested today, and if you were taken to trial and the charge was that you were a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? That's the question that the chronicler wanted people to know, that God loves you. He still is available if you call on his name, if you make God your one thing. It's not bad to have a word, but the reality is the word has to be under the authority of God. This week in the word, every day I've been focusing on one word, that word focus. And I've been reading a book. One of my goals is that I read two books a month. And one of the books that I'm reading right now is called What Does Your Soul Love? 8 Questions That Reveal God's Work in You. It's by a couple named Jim and Alan Fadling. I highly encourage you to get it. It's called What Does Your Soul Love? And in that book, they ask a question that challenged me this week. And the question is this: what do you want? What do you want, Harvest? What do you want in 2020? I have a lot of people that come and ask me to be a mentor or help them in different things, and The first question often that I ask them after who they are is, what do you want? Because if you don't know what you want, I can't help you or determine whether or not I have what it is that you need. The question is, what do you want? And David, Solomon's dad, paved the way for what we see today in Psalm chapter 27. I want to leave this with you because David had one thing that he was focused on. There's a lot of things as a king that he could have had and could have wanted, but this is what he said. In chapter 27 of Psalm, verse 4, one thing have I asked of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. That's what he wanted. He wanted to be with God. That's all he wanted, is to be with God. So here's three takeaways that I received that I want to give to you for this week. David wanted to dwell in the house of the Lord. He wanted to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. And gazing takes time. It's not something you do in a hurry. He wanted to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. And then it says he wanted to seek the Lord. Harvest in 2020. If harvest is called by my name, if we choose to humble ourselves and pray, if we choose to turn from our wicked ways, then God will hear from heaven and he'll heal our church. This week, I want you to ask the question, is God your one thing? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for every person that is seated here. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the opportunity to share your word, and not just your word, but share our dreams and even our failures. But we thank you that failure is never final in you, because you said that if we put you first, that you would glorify us. We ask that in the humble, matchless name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Let's stand and respond to the Lord in worship.